Clef Notes, an analysis of the music in HBO's Game of Thrones.
Hey there. Welcome to another, well, this is kind of a special edition. It's an edition of Matt's audio blog and an edition for Podcast Winterfell, if they choose to carry it. It's a special kind of Clef Notes edition that I used to do for Podcast Winterfell, and I wanted to do what I feel will be a preview for the music of Season 8. As you know, I'm not a person who likes to do predictions or what have you, so not big on all of that so much, but I do feel like that there are some themes that we naturally are going to hear in Season 8, and I'd just like to preview it for both sets of listeners so that they know what to listen for when we hear Season 8 and what these themes might mean. If you've been listening to Matt's audio blog or to Podcast Winterfell anytime in the last 5-6 years, then you probably already know that I'm more about the music of the show sometimes than I am about the story of the show, although I do enjoy the story as well. Let me just say a couple things first. If you're listening to this on Podcast Winterfell, be sure to check out that podcast at podcastwinterfell.com. Or you can check out the DVR Podcast Network at dvrpodcast.com. And that's Axel Foley and Heath and DJ Tim Hines and Tracy and Mike and Donald. All those guys will be covering Game of Thrones for you this season. So be sure to check up with them and see what kind of schedule they're doing. I think Axel is doing a Podcast Winterfell rewatch of the seasons with weekly updates, so be sure to check that out. If you're wondering what happened to me, well, I gave up Podcast Winterfell because I was touring a lot, and then a lot of things changed, and now I'm back to podcasting again, but I loved what Axel did with the format and everything, so I'm just leaving that to him. And I am at mattsaudioblog.com, and if you want to contact me, mattsaudioblog@gmail.com, or you can tweet to mattsgotblog on Twitter. All that out of the way, let's take a look at some of the music that I think we're going to hear this particular season, and not just the themes themselves, but the ways that we might hear them that will help to tell this story. We're in the end game of this story, naturally. Somewhere at the end of all of this, we'll have either all been destroyed by the Night King, or we will have all been vindicated against the Night King in one way or another. I don't know if that necessarily means that the Night King will be destroyed or not, but I do think that in order for humanity to survive, then obviously the Night King has to be neutralized in some way or another. Also, there is the quest for who will sit on the throne last, and what that might necessarily mean for that as well. You don't know if it might be Danny. Given John's heritage, it might be John. At least for a brief while, we know it's going to be Cersei. And in the end, I don't know that it'll really matter. I'm kind of with our friend Bubba from the Joffrey of Podcast and thinking that nobody will be sitting the throne at the end. Or maybe that was Catfish. I can't remember which one of them thinks that. But I honestly believe that the visions from Bran and Danny in the House of the Undying tells us that the throne will be vacant sometime in the future and never again to be filled. But those are weird kind of story predictions. We don't need to talk about that. But how might the music actually fulfill the story that we're about to see? Well, obviously, we're going to have the main theme. We're going to have the Stark theme, probably in one way or another, Lannister theme, even the Euron and the other Greyjoy theme. All of these themes that we associate with characters will come into play. The Lord of Light theme surely will come into play if we see Melisandre or anybody from that religion. And there's lots of things that can be done, depending on the way the story goes, to change what those themes mean. And one thing that I really like to think about is the fact that the main theme, even in its very initial run in the very first season, when you first heard that come on, it had some minor aspects to it. And there was this one little phrase that had a major aspect to it. And that was brought back in season 6 after John had been resurrected and he came out and he saw everybody in the episode. And now his watch is ended. You heard a major version of the theme being played. And it had this kind of bittersweetness to it as well, because John was going to ultimately leave the Night's Watch in that episode. He had fulfilled his oath, by the way, and now we know that he has a much bigger role to play in the whole structure of the Game of Thrones being played, and the fact that he is a legitimate heir to the throne. But just the way that that was phrased kind of moved John into a bigger platform than where he had been. He wasn't just defending against the wildlings or the Night's Watch in the wall. He was suddenly a much larger figure than that. Well, he'd been brought back for the dead, for one. He was resurrected. As Melisandre would have put it, he was reborn as Azor Ahai, the prince that was promised. And he actually is a prince, now we know. So he may very well be the prince that was promised. But he is the hope side of the overall picture, the overall story. And Ramin, in one way, really phrased it really well by doing the main motif, that is the little snippet, that dun 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 dun. We're so used to hearing that being minor. But even in the very first season, there was one little phrase where it was major. And in this particular episode, he really emphasized the whole idea of the majorness. And major makes us feel more happy, more hopeful, whereas minor makes us feel more sad or more scared. And listen to this clip right at the beginning here, with just this little motive of when John first comes out, and listen to how the theme feels more heroic, more hopeful in this way, or at least that little motive of the theme. It's a really weird kind of feeling, isn't it, to hear it drawn out in such a major way? But it also does have that bittersweetness to it, in the fact that the major chord comes from what we call the root chord, where the home key feels like. The home key feels like it's major, like this. But Ramin does something special in the fact that he borrows really from pop music in a lot of ways. And that is something that pop music writers have been doing for a long time, making the root chord, the home key, sound major. But when they go to a different note in the key or a different part of the key, they make that minor. And that's exactly what Ramin does here. He leaves things hanging on the minor aspect of it. Now, you don't have to know the difference between major and minor, but you can tell that there's something different about the second chord, this chord. Then this chord, the root chord. And that second chord is minor. It implies the minor key, even though we're rooted in the major key. So there is an implied sadness within our happiness. And I feel like that that's going to happen a lot in this particular season. There are going to be victories for our heroes, but they are going to come at a cost. And that's why I feel like we might hear versions of this like we did in season 6 yet again in season 8. I feel like that there are going to be major victories for our heroes in regards to the overall picture, but there's also going to be a bittersweetness to it, because we're going to lose people as we achieve those goals. And I think that one of the ways that Ramin will characterize that is through this kind of sequence. But who are the people that we're going to lose? Who are the people that are going to stay? Before we get into that, let's talk about the environment that we might lose people in, or that we might become victorious in. For a long time, the gonging that we hear, often associated with the wall more than anything else, in like the wall theme and what have you, that gonging, I've not associated with the theme itself, but where the theme is happening. For instance, in the wall theme in season one, Ramin started with those kind of gongs that to me indicate the coldness of winter, like this. And of course, those gongs do make us think of the wall. It's even part of the wall theme, but to me, it is something that is separate from the theme itself. It's an environmental cue. It's something that represents the snow and the cold and everything that we've associated mostly with the North. And let's face it, when we've heard the gongs, it's mostly been in the North, except that we heard those same gongs when Dany was having her vision in the House of the Undying and she saw the Iron Throne empty. And you'll hear that the music has nothing to do with the wall theme. But the gongs are there nonetheless. And that is as the winter is seemingly snowing in on the Iron Throne. Now, I know a lot of people said it was ashes or what have you, but I've always associated it with snow itself simply because of this music cue. So to me, that makes it feel like that the gongs are separate from anything except the environment that our characters or the scene is in. And that means it's not necessarily associated with the Night's Watch. It's not necessarily associated with the Night King or the White Walkers. It's something that is on its own, can be independent, because winter is coming whether the Night King is coming or not. Right? There's still winter is going to happen. It's a season that has happened many times without the Night King before. And so this represents the cold, the snow, and we can hear it anywhere in any of the scenes as winter is approaching or as winter is present, which should be in just about all of the episodes, save maybe if we get a spring at the end or something like that. So, with that said, let's move on to something else. Something that is very important, and that is character themes, or themes that represent religions or what have you, because all of that's going to come into play, of course, a great deal in this particular season. We're going to lose characters. We're going to see characters triumph. We're going to see characters sacrifice. And you might as well start right at the top, correct? You might as well start with our main heroes, who I think now we can identify distinctly as John and Danny. Those are our main protagonists in this story. Everybody has their favorites of the lesser protagonists, say like a Tyrion or what have you. And everybody has their favorite antagonists, say like a Euron or a Cersei. But in terms of the greater threat to humanity, our main protagonists seem to be John and Danny. And they have their own theme itself, which I feel like we have to hear at least one more time, no matter whether Bran and Sam tell John right away who he is and they find that out or not. There's going to have to be a moment where either that love is just embraced and screw the news, or there's going to be a moment where they have to let that love go. And that's going to be represented by their love theme, which started in season 7 very slowly, kind of in the background, and finally built up to the big scene where they were together on the boat, which sounded like this. To me, it just seems inevitable that this is going to happen, that we're going to hear this. Now, the big question is, will it be as grandiose as this? Well, if either John or Danny do some kind of great sacrifice for one or the other, then probably so, because it'll be a very emotional moment. If it's just the dying of their love, maybe it'll be a lot more subdued. Those are questions that I could only speculate on, but I do feel like that we need to hear this theme at least one more time in season 8. Regardless of what happens with John and Danny in terms of their love or whether they give up themselves for one another or what have you, I do feel like that they're each going to have their own individually powerful moments as well. And one of the things that I keep thinking about is we have to have dragon moments. We just simply have to have dragon moments. And there is Dany's dragon connection theme that is associated with her as much as it is with the dragons. There is her own personal theme, love in the eyes, which I feel like is part of who Dany is just as much as it was a thing for her and Drogo. And so I think we'll hear that. And I think that we're going to hear John's theme that came out of the Now My Watch Has Ended queue, where he kind of graduated to having his own theme for the very first time. He wasn't no longer associated with the Starks. He was no longer associated with the Night's Watch, even though we still thought he was a Stark at the time. He graduated into his own kind of theme in season 6 as well. And I want to go through each of these just a little bit. I think that these will be very powerful moments. So I've been scouring through some of the scenes where we hear really big moments of this. And I'm going to start with the dragon connection theme because it's had a lot of really powerful moments in the series. Let's listen to this one. We'll be right back. Yeah, that's a huge moment, right? That's just a big theme. And I know a lot of people associate this with Dany alone, but it's not. It's her connection to the dragons. It was first introduced, actually, when Dany was still holding one of the eggs. We heard just a very faint sound of that theme. And if you go back to Matt's audio blog podcast, in one of the season one episodes, I covered that. But that theme has grown to become huge, just as the dragons have become huge. And this is Dany's connection to the dragons themselves. Now, on top of that, Dany has her own kind of theme that we've heard, of course, many times. It's Love in the Eyes is what the theme was originally called in the season one soundtrack. And it was more about her and Drogo initially, but it has grown to become Dany as a Khaleesi, which is what she truly is. She's a queen and a Khaleesi, and she's a fierce leader. And I feel like we have to have at least one individual moment with Dany where we hear this theme. Here's the funny thing about that particular clip. That was actually when Barristan was fighting off the, him and Grey Worm were fighting off the Sons of the Harpy, right? In that episode in season 5. But I feel like that's the kind of context that we're going to hear the Dany theme in, more so than the beating drums and what have you of the original version of the theme. Less of the flute kind of sounds like we were used to in season one, and much more of the horn kind of sounds that we hear in season 5 and beyond. So that's the theme from Dany that I think we'll hear a lot of, or at least one big moment of, depending on what happens to Dany. And again, that would just be speculating, but I do feel like that that's the kind of context that we will hear her theme in at least. We may hear it in lesser contexts as well. It will depend on how quickly and how far apart John and Dany are separated, I think, as to how individual and how many different treatments of their themes we get. Which brings me to John's theme, which, I, as I mentioned before, we heard back in season 6. We will definitely hear that again, because he's going to have a couple of moments on his own that separate him from just him and Dany being together and fighting this thing, either for the throne or against the Night King, together. They're each going to have their individual moments, and I think we'll hear some version of this. Now, that was the main statement of the theme that came from that episode where John told Ed that he was his watch is ended. But I don't know that we'll hear it in that context. We may very well hear it in that context in some way or another, but we will probably also hear it in a battle type of thing. And I'm reminded of the Against All Odds cut from the season 7 soundtrack, where you heard John's theme faintly because he was left to fight the White Walkers all by himself, right? And so you could hear his theme faintly as the chaos was happening. And this is what you heard, this version of the theme right here. And those are the basic outlines of our main protagonists, right? So let's turn to our main antagonists. And that would be the Night King, obviously, and Cersei, I suppose. With that, the biggest threat, obviously, is the Night King. And Ramin at the end of season 7 went all out with the White Walker theme. It originally started really quiet because it was such a distant threat in the very first episode of the series, like this. That's just a whisper of the theme, right? And again, it was off in the distance. We didn't know what it was yet. We didn't know how much of a threat it could be. There's this huge wall that these guys just came out from behind. They're probably protected, right? Then things got more and more fierce, like at the Fist of the First Men. And then later on, as Sam had to defend Gilly, and even further on into the seasons, by the time we get to Hardhome, a full-on orchestrated version of this theme makes it extremely menacing, like this. And we all know that the story just absolutely dictates that somebody fight the Night King again, be it John and Danny or somewhere else. Something has to happen to be in confrontation with these guys, so you're definitely going to hear that again. Now, will you hear big versions, small versions? Not sure. Maybe you might hear another small version once the Night King is defeated. I don't know. I just don't know. Or I don't even know if the Night King will be defeated for that matter, but I kind of hope so. Not much point in following all these characters if they all die. Or maybe that is the point. Who knows? Anyway, forget about story speculation. Just know that we're definitely going to hear that kind of music, probably in that bigger context yet again. Maybe in the smaller context too, depending on what happens to the Night King. And I'm going to turn to my other antagonist, Cersei. And normally, of course, we associate with the Lannister theme. But I'm going to kind of skip that for now, because the theme for Cersei has graduated out of the Lannister theme. She's kind of become her own person. And she has, of course, ever since the end of season 6, graduated to her own theme that it seems like everybody in the world, except me, loves. I do like the theme. Don't get me wrong. I do like the theme. I just didn't like the instrumentation of which it was introduced. But I could see it being reduced back to that towards the end for Cersei. Whatever that end is she going to live? Is she going to die? I don't know. But is her reign going to end? Is it not? I don't know. But I could see a reduced individual moment where it goes back to the piano from the big orchestrations that we've had lately. But I do like the bigger orchestrations. Here's an example of one right here after Jaime leaves Cersei behind. The Light of the Seven theme, as it is called. It should have actually been called the Lighting of the Seven, because that's exactly what Cersei did. She blew everybody up. Anyway, here's the theme that I feel that we will hear around Cersei in some way or some manner at some point. While I'm talking about Cersei, of course, she may have a moment where she gets the Lannister theme underneath her. There's lots of potentials for the Lannister theme. As I said, I would get to that here in a second, and I am now at that point. We can associate the Lannister theme with any number of characters. We can associate it with Cersei. We can associate it with Tyrion. We can associate it with Jaime. And I think that we're more likely to hear this theme played for Jaime or Tyrion than for Cersei herself. However, there's always the possibility that Cersei could be associated with it too, because the story of the Reigns of Castamere is actually a pretty dark one, right? It's one of destruction and everything. It's a matter of Lannister pride, and it feels to me like Tyrion and Jaime have both started to give up some of that Lannister pride or that Lannister vengeance kind of factor as opposed to Cersei, but it's still who they are, right? So I feel like that if we're going to get the Lannister theme at all, it'll likely be more with Jaime and Tyrion than with Cersei. But just so you're familiar, if you aren't already, this is one of those themes that everybody seems to know. It is the Lannister theme right here. So we've now covered the two main thrusts of the story for the endgame, I think. We've covered the living against the dead, and we've covered the battle for the throne itself in a lot of ways, because you feel like that's going to involve Jon and Dany and Cersei and Jon and Dany and the Night King, and I'm not sure who's going to survive what. I don't really want to know. I want to be surprised by all of that. But I feel like that those are the two main thrusts of the story. I think we can all agree on that. There are the sidebars. And there's a lot of information that's going to have to be conveyed between characters and what have you, and directions that individual characters are going to have to go, be they surviving or not surviving, whatever happens in this season. I think a lot of characters are going to die, but I don't know which ones so much. That you can make some pretty good guesses, probably just because you feel their importance to the story is diminished. Nonetheless, let's talk about the character themes now, or the house themes. At the end of season 7, we got a really, really nice version of the Stark theme. You felt like, for the first time, that Arya and Sansa were united in... you know, remembering their father, which was a really nice moment. And you got this version of the Stark theme right here.
And the snows fall and the white winds blow. The lone wolf dies, but the pack survives.
I miss him.
Now, the question becomes, will we hear a Stark United theme again? It's great to have Arya and Sansa and Bran all in Winterfell once again. But Bran's not really Bran anymore, is he? He's much more the Three-Eyed Raven, and we've heard that theme associated more with him lately, all throughout Season 7, more or less. And I feel like if we're going to hear stuff that is specific to Bran and not Stark-oriented, we're going to hear that Three-Eyed Raven theme yet again. We first heard it in Season 4. Now we're hearing it more associated with Bran because he essentially is the Three-Eyed Raven, right? I'm talking about this. And Arya herself is very much changed. She, while not actually becoming no one, certainly has the skills of no one and is capable of becoming someone else all of the time or at any time. So she's not going to be associated as much with the Stark theme, I think, unless she's in Sansa's presence. I think we're still going to hear a couple of moments of that Faceless Man theme coming back in for Arya in some kind of incorporation. Maybe some kind of weird incorporation with the Stark theme in a way, because she's kind of both, maybe not. But I'm not sure if we'll hear the Stark theme directly associated with her unless she's around other Starks. I think when she decides to finish her list off, if that's what she decides to do, then she's going to be having much more music like this behind her when she does so. Now, I'm not certain that every scene we have with Arya won't have some version of the Stark theme with her. I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying that I'm not sure that she's given up on her mission to take care of everybody on her list. And if that's the case, I think the actions on those lists will represent something somewhat like we just heard. That leaves Sansa to be the sole representative alone of the Stark theme. Sansa's never really had her own kind of theme. However, she's been associated a lot with Littlefinger's theme because she spent a lot of time with Littlefinger. Wouldn't it be weird if some kind of combination of the Stark theme connected with the Littlefinger theme to represent Sansa at some point? Not that Sansa's evil, not like Littlefinger at all, but she has become a thinker, like Littlefinger. And sometimes I just wonder what those two themes would sound like. I'm going to attempt here on the piano to convey what I'm thinking about. And folks, that's just pure speculation. I hope it's not the case, to be perfectly honest. But if there is any way to individualize the family together and each of the individuals apart, saving Sansa getting her own theme in season 8, which is also possible, that I can't even possibly imagine, then I would think that this might be a nice alternative for Sansa. So there's the Stark family in a nutshell. We've covered the main Stark theme, the individual themes, ridiculous speculation on my part regarding Sansa, and there's still more characters around everybody, these main principal things that need to be explored. We have Jaime and Brienne. We're going to tackle that next. And I think that you can't help but use the oath theme. Actually, it started back in season 1 between Ned and Catelyn. And it was graduated then to more of a theme for Brienne in season 2 when she made her oath to Catelyn to protect her and serve her. And we've heard that time and time again associated with Brienne and with Brienne and Jaime. And so we have this aspect to think about as far as the two of them together or Brienne on her own. And of course, we've heard it in that more subdued way. We've also heard it in a battle kind of way when Brienne was trying to escape Littlefinger's men and when Brienne was saving Sansa from Bolton's men, like this. And so you might hear either version, the more subdued version, or the battle version, or both, possibly, from Brienne's side of things. From Jaime's side of things, he does have his own individual theme as well. And that was from season 3, when he was telling the story in the bath about how he saved King's Landing, basically, from a wildfire disaster. And we heard that again when Brienne and Jaime were saying goodbye to each other in, what was that, season 6, when they were waving goodbye at River Run as Brienne and Podrick were escaping. But I really love the season 3 version. It's so emotional. It's one of the best themes in the whole thing. And I hope that, regardless of what happens to Jaime, that we get at least one last version of this theme for Jaime. Again, doesn't matter what happens to him, whether he him victorious and living or sacrificing himself and dead. I do hope we get at least one more version of this theme in season 8. So, we have that going on, and it feels to me like you can't have a battle with the White Walkers unless you have an Azor Ahai representative. And the Azor Ahai representative, be that John or Danny, is still going to be believed to be Azor Ahai by the people of the Lord of Light faith. That religion will be prevalent and at least represented by Melisandre, maybe by other characters. We had the reveal of the one Red Priestess, Daenerys, about the flame. Do you recall what he said? Do you recall whose voice you heard? Blah, blah, blah. That was a little weird. We'll see if that gets panned out or whatever by someone else besides Melisandre. Melisandre's made a prophecy about her and Varys dying in a strange land. There's all kinds of things that could happen with this. But regardless, it's going to be Melisandre's biggest call to faith to see if she can help this cause to defeat the Night King. And that means we're going to hear the Lord of Light. Now, will we hear the usual version that we're used to from season 2? Will we hear a more orchestrated version like we heard in the end of, what was that, the Red Woman episode in season 6? Hard to say, but keep this theme in mind because I feel like it's going to return at least one time in season 8 for sure. There are some other minor themes, like the Grey Worm Missandei theme. Feel like we have to hear that again. I'm not going to go into playing that because I'm running out of time, given the time restrictions that I give myself to put out a podcast. But there is one other family that we need to cover, and that's the Greyjoy family. And I feel for certain that we're going to hear the Euron theme. We heard it mostly when he was anointed king at the Kingsmoot. That was the first introduction of his theme in real presence. But here's a representation of the theme itself. And to counter that, we, of course, will have to have Theon fighting against it. And at the end of Season 7, one of my favorite versions of the Greyjoy theme made it kind of a more of a major kind of theme. And I think we might hear snippets of that in Theon's heroism. Whether he defeats Euron or not, or whether he saves Yara or not, that's a big question. But I think we really need to root for Theon more so than him just saying, "For Yara!" at the end of Season 7. But here's a version of that moment, actually, that I hope that we hear more of in season 8.
Not for me. For Yara!
And that's all I have for you. I appreciate your time listening to this. Remember, if you're listening on Podcast Winterfell, be sure to follow the podcast at Winterfell Pod on Twitter. You can always email them all throughout season 8, podcastwinterfell@gmail.com. Be sure to check out the DVR Podcast Network. That's dvrpodcast.com. And if you want to check out my podcast that I'm doing separately from Podcast Winterfell, even though I hope to be interacting with these guys quite often throughout season 8, then feel free to follow me at Matt's GOT blog on Twitter, or mattsaudioblog@gmail.com or mattsaudioblog.com. Thanks for your time. Have a great season 8.